of 2023. The class of 2023's motto is, if you only do what you can, you'll never be more than you are now. Our verse, the Lord is my light and my foundation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Psalms 21, verse 1. And our aim is to see you guys at the welcome table.
I just wanted to let you all know, this is not my regular voice. So, I promise, I've never smoked in my life. But through the next 10 minutes, you're going to have to bear with me with this, all right? And before I get into my speech, some of you probably know what Be Real is, right? It's like social media, but for happy people. So, my Be Real's going off, and I'm going to take one. And if you guys want to, like, wave your hand or something, then that'll be cool. All right, I'll tell you guys when. Ready? I'm gonna get you guys in two. All right? Yeah! Woo!
Can you see me, bro?
You can see you. You got it. Okay, now time for the actual speech. All right. Good afternoon to all the lovely parents and relatives, great friends, spectacular staff, and of course, the class of 23. Class of 23, we made it. We're here. This is our day. I'm here today by the miracles of God as the valedictorian of the class of 2023. And I would not be in this position today without everyone in my class and all of the supportive teachers and all the staff. But before I get on with the powerful and inspirational message I'm supposed to be giving today, I want to take you guys on a trip down memory lane with our class. So starting off with freshman year, okay, now sophomore year, no one cares about freshman year. No, I'm just kidding. But this year was really rough for us. It started off pretty strong. We were the biggest class at HVA, but then COVID hit. And freshman year was also my worst year academically as well. And that's very sad, I know. But so before our class was able to finish out the year, COVID sent all of us online. However, that did not stop us from making memories, from making eggs in Zoom class, to mastering multitasking by watching YouTube and listening to the lectures. It was a wild start to high school. But once we were back in person, we only grew more memories together. Herbert falling through the door in his desk in health class. SparkNotes carrying our English quiz grade. I'm sorry, Miss Mason. Being insanely unprepared for our senior play, but it's still going well. Car washes and yard sales. Our government class with Mrs. Lutz turning into fundraising strategies, therapy sessions, and honestly anything but government class. And our super hardcore and intense senior survival that took place in the gym. Our relentless class spirit in all the Campus Cup events. And of course, our class trip to Puerto Rico, which was bought with all the blood, sweat, and tears we went through on this four-year journey. These are a fraction of all the memories, and I could go on and on about them throughout the four-year journey. Now, you may be wondering how all of these crazy moments in our class connect back to my inspirational and very moving speech. You know, I feel like adding words like moving, inspirational, or putting a little bit unnecessary pressure. So hopefully I'll make someone cry tears of joy with this. I'm talking about you, Mrs. Lutz. So I briefly mentioned how my freshman year was my worst year academically. Now I know it's coming from an Asian household, you think my bad grades are anything under a 98, but trust me, my grades were very mediocre. Sophomore year, and especially junior year and senior year, when the workload started to get a lot tougher, I decided to stop being lazy and work for what I wanted in my life. Success and status are always things that I've wanted in my life, and all these things seem to be worth it for me. And for those who don't know me, I tend to have a soft spot for things I can't afford. But with my career goal being dentistry, which is a very competitive and cutthroat field, I knew that I had to work hard. And so I did, and so far it's all paid off. However, being valedictorian or getting good grades is not the path to success that I once thought it would be. I once imagined that the path to success was paved with your never-ending hard work and the constant struggle to get what you want in life. This is what I was prepared to do in order to be successful. Yes, good grades and working hard are important for success, but there's one thing that is more important than all of that. Something that's worth a lot more than money, grades, or a valedictorian title, and that is relationships. I have a high ambition and I want to be successful in my future, of course, but finding shortcuts and getting good grades and a title, that's not the path to success. It might feel good for a little bit when you have money and success, but then before you know it, you're 50 years old and you start seeing your own kids go to high school. You sit there watching and wonder, why did I waste these years? Why did I never leave my comfort zone and make new friends? Why was I so concerned with being the smartest, the most athletic, or the most liked? All of this success for what? Let me tell you what the real path to success looks like. The real path to success, the one that's true and firm, is the one with all the memories I just listed about our class throughout the years. All the relationships and friendships that we built these past 4 years, that's what's most important, is relationships. I could be the hardest working person in the entire world, and have all the money I want taking cavities out of crying kids' teeth. But if I lacked any of the relationship aspects that HVA has brought to my life, through my friends, my teachers, it'd all be for nothing. Jesus says in John 13:34 that the greatest command is to love one another just as he loves us, that there's no greater love than to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. That is success. The reason true success lies within relationships and not wealth or status is because those things are only temporary. The relationships that we make now are going to stay with us when Jesus takes us home. Good relationships are the foundation for success. They're the building blocks to which everything on the path to success follows. Every successful person has been truly successful because of at least one good relationship they've had. And if you find one that says they didn't, ask them how they truly feel that their life is a success right now. As each of us moves into new stages of our life, some of us may go to college to be doctors, lawyers, or teachers. Others may go straight to work. Someone in our class might end up being one of your bosses one day. But the money we make and the status that we might acquire and the diplomas that we're receiving today are not what measure our success. The memories that we made here together and the relationships that we created, those will carry with us for the rest of our lives. Each person we encounter has the opportunity to our life, whether benefiting it or creating strife. Moving on, we have the opportunity to create new relationships with others, to make new sisters and brothers. God has given us each specific talent. He wants us to build new relationships, and this cannot be bought. Some people use this a lot, and while others don't even give it a thought. We can be so eager to turn life's pages when things get tough, when we should be slowing down and learning through these hard stages. Healthy relationships that are never forgotten is what equals success, not the awards, titles, perfection that lead to stress. What does it say about a person's life if their life mission is to seek recognition? How can we grow if we don't let God show us where to go? We are headed into our futures, a place that has many unknowns, but realize that you will never be alone if you allow God in your zone. I hope you enjoyed poetry with Brendan. Now, this is no excuse to not work hard. You should work hard in whatever you do. Just don't work too hard, because then you'll be forced to give a last-minute speech in front of a lot of people. But in all seriousness, relationships is how we get to true success. We will continue to have to forge new types of relationships in the future, and these relationships will help us determine who we become. Now, the most common question that all of us are going to be asked right after this is, what do we want to do in college? What do we want to do with the rest of our lives? I don't know about you, but when I was little, I wanted to be a firefighter, an astronaut, a garbage man, and Iron Man when I was young. Sadly, astronauts are no longer on the list. However, I think that the question should be, who do we want to be when we grow up? Because what we are defines us very little. It is who we are and how we grow that reaches true success. I'm sure that we can all agree that we've all experienced a major growth since freshman year. The extremely puzzled and obnoxious freshmen that we were are not the same grown and somewhat mature seniors that we are today. The ones that are ready to take on the world. However, we still have so much more to learn. We still have so much more to contribute to the world. As seniors, it was our job and our responsibility to leave a good legacy of our character in this school. Now, as we're all moving forward in all of our separate directions, it is our job to leave a footprint of greatness in our everyday world. And this greatness is not money, it's not success, a valedictorian title, or anything like that. It is these relationships that we have made, the relationships that have made us who we are, the relationships that we have built together here on this campus, and the relationships that we will form together in our futures. leaving that type of legacy and spreading that type of relational love that Jesus gave to us, that's what true success looks like. And I'm sure that each and every one of us here can achieve that. And I can't wait until we all meet together at the welcome table in heaven, where we hear about the amazing legacies that we all left and the relationships that we made that led us to finding true success. I love all of you guys and wish you all the very, very best in wherever God takes you. Thank you.
Hello. Wow, this is kind of nerve-wracking. All right. Good morning, friends and family. If some of you guys don't know me, hi, I'm Sophia, and I've had the privilege and honor of being class president all 4 years. I want all of you to know that I've been looking forward to this moment since freshman year, getting to stand and speak to my class one last time. Over the years, I've compiled so many thoughts and ideas of what I wanted to say, and yet as I was writing this, I was struggling to find the right words to truly express how much all of you guys mean to me. So bear with me as I attempt to continue on with the speech. Most of you guys should know that English was never my forte in school. Dear class of 2023, for the past 4 years, we have been longing for this moment. This is it, you guys. Our time has come. I remember as if it was yesterday when we were all freshmen, dreaming about all the adventures that we were gonna have, dreaming about how our senior selves were going to be like, and dreaming about stuff like class trip. While we didn't go to the Virgin Islands, Puerto Rico was a close second. Having the opportunity to travel to an tropical island together, wake up to ocean sounds together, enjoy the rowdiest ocean waves together, hike miles worth of rocks and beach together, and experiencing that intense Caribbean sun, but most importantly of all, spending our last moments as a class together was so special. All of my hopes and dreams about senior class trip came true. We were blessed to have booked an amazing Airbnb right on the beach. This house was legit. It fit all 24 of us with plenty of space. The house came with a pool, a jacuzzi, volleyball court, big living rooms, and places to hang out. And the sweetest thing of all was having that private beach all to ourselves. Every day was an adventure. We'd wake up for sunrises, find cool nature gems, go night swimming. While I could honestly stand up here and talk about this trip, it's important to know that while this destination that all of us have ever dreamed of was more precious was the journey that got us there. So let's travel back in time before it all began. I was a naive 14-year-old girl coming from a public school to a private Christian boarding school. I've pretty much lived away from home ever since then. At that time of my life, I was a different person. I was lost, looking for something I didn't even know what it was. As many of us know, freshman year was a whole wreck. All of us had our ups and our downs, but mostly downs, some more than others, in particular me. For me, I was struggling to find a new family away from home, struggling to find myself, and struggling to see God work in my life. Looking back now, I see that God was there all along. I'm a firm believer that everything happens for a purpose. You guys were what I needed to get me along this way. I found my family away from home. You guys are all my brothers and sisters. We laugh like family, we struggle together like family, and we stick together like family. In you guys, I found identity. You guys gave me purpose. Through each and every one of you, I found God. Each of you guys possess characteristics of God that not only hasn't impacted me, but has impacted our entire community. Katie, God is love, and he has given you the gift of love. Throughout our journey together at HVA, you have shown so much love to all of us. I've never questioned your authenticity. Your love has turned my bad days into ones that weren't so bad after all. Katie, as you go out into the world, continue to spread love to everyone you meet. Googie, God is welcoming, and he has blessed you with the gift of being welcoming. You took people for how they were, no matter what. You have never switched up on anybody. You are always your 100% authentic self. You treat everyone around you like family. Gugi, as you go out into the world, continue to build those relationships and communities. Kia, God is light, and he has poured brightness onto you. I admire everything about you. Your heart, your soul, and your mind are pure like light. Every time I see you, it's a breath of fresh air. Thank you for spreading your light here at HVA. And Kia, as you go out into the world, continue to shine. Hannah, God is consistent, and so are you. You are consistently saving our English grades. But most importantly, you have consistently shown us all your love and support. As you go out into this world, continue to be consistent through your life, because I know you're going to do great things. Alex, God is my advocate, and he has given you the gift of advocacy. He has filled you up with so much love and passion for those in need. You use your voice to fight for those who are voiceless. Alex, as you pursue law, use God's gift he has given you and become the best advocate for those who need it. Herbert, God is good, and he has made your heart good. As much as you may deny it, you actually are one of the kindest and most caring men I have ever met. You have always shown up and helped in any way you could, and you show all of us so much love. So Herbert, as you go out into the world, continue to be the good wherever you go. Carlos, God is dependable, and so are you. Even through hard times, Carlos, you have shown up and you have been there for your class. I really admire that about you. You have always been someone that I could look up to or look to and know that you'd be there for me. Carlos, as you go out into the world, continue to be that reliable and dependable person for others, just how you were to all of us. Brandon, God is true, and he has made you true. Throughout all these years at HVA, you have always been you. You have never been afraid to speak out for what's right, and you have never wavered. Brandon, as you go out into the world, never lose sight of who you truly are, because who you really are is really cool. Julie, God is powerful, and he has given you the gift of being powerful. Your words can truly move mountains. You have never been afraid to speak your mind, and I admire that about you. Julie, as you go out into the world, never lose that fire that's within you and empower others. Malcolm, God is a personal God, and he has made you personal. You've always been that guy in our class to reach out to all of us. You were always the first one to help someone out during their hard times. Malcolm, as you go out into the world, continue to build those connections and truly make an impact on people's lives. Brendan, God is wise, and he has given you the gift of wisdom. Not only are you really smart, but you are really wise. You always know right from wrong, what is good, and you willingly share that knowledge with those who need it. Brendan, as you go out into the world, continue to spread the light of your wisdom to every dark corner. Sam, God is a leader, and he has blessed you with the ability of being a leader. Throughout these years, you have stepped up into roles that have really fulfilled them all. Being a leader is basically second nature to you. Sam, as you go out into the world, don't be afraid to be that leader I know you are. Isabel, God is patient, and so are you. You have really been patient with HVA. I know when you first came and joined, you weren't really sure if you liked it here. But you were patient with us and gave us the chance to show you how great it could really be. Isabel, as you go out into the world, continue to be patient with others just how you were with us. Mario, God is my protector, and he has given you the gift of protecting. As much as you sometimes deny, you actually do care. You have protected all of us at least once in our time here together at HVA. I admire how you go to the moon and back to protect the ones you love. Mario, as you go out into the world, continue to have that passion to protect your loved ones. Davian, God is peaceful, and so are you. I have never seen this man get angry before. You have always kept such a calm and gentle composure. You handle situations in a way that I could never replicate. Davian, as you go out into the world, be that sense of peace in people's lives. Nate, God is resilient, and he has given you the gift of resiliency. No matter how tough things got, to try and knock you down, you always fight to stand right back up. You have never let the bad win in your life. Nate, as you go out into the world, continue to show that resiliency and inspire others to do the same. Okay, God is joy, and you are very joyful. You make everyone around you laugh and smile every day just by seeing you. You have always been the good through the bad. Okay, as you go out into the world, spread your joy to the lives around you because it has truly blessed each and every one of us. Josh, God is gracious, and he has given you the gift of being gracious. Josh, you have shown a lot of grace to many of us. You accept everyone in this class no matter who they are. You have always been so kind, even when we roast you. Josh, as you go out into the world, continue to show your grace to everyone around you just as you have to us. Kamari, God is strength, and so are you. I truly admire how you carry yourself and how independent you truly are. You never let anyone or anything drag you down. You always keep your head up and keep moving forward. Kamari, as you go out into the world, never lose that strength. And lastly, Ms. Lutz and Ms. McCain, God is faithful, and so are both of you. Throughout our 4 years being here, you guys were always the ones who we could count on. You have never let any of us down. Thank you for everything that you've done for us, and thank you for treating us like your kids, and we love you. The biggest part of my speech is now over, so don't worry. You guys showed me God every day in so many different ways. Thank you for being such an amazing group of people. As our time together is coming to an end, I want to leave you with one last piece of advice. Slow down. Life is not a race, but rather a journey. As we leave this place and go out into the world, remember to focus on the here and now. No one is guaranteed tomorrow. You don't know how many times this year I've heard, I've got senioritis, or I just want to graduate. But now our time is over. We won't ever get to sing welcome table together again. We won't ever sit in a classroom together again, or even waste time in classes together again. Now we only have the memory of those things. And I'm going to cherish the four-year journey full of those memories that have led us right here. I hope as all of us grow up, we remember to stop, breathe, and live. Don't go through life only looking forward to the end goal of what the world deems accomplishments. If you do, you will miss out on the beauty of today that God has to offer. Class of 2023, you guys have become my happy place and my safe place. I love every one of you so deeply. I know that God has big plans for each and every one of us, and that we're gonna go out into the world and make a difference in a way that matters. I can't wait for all of us to come back in 10 years and catch up on all the new memories we've made and the journeys we've taken. I can't wait to see who's right and who's wrong about all of our predictions. Life is gonna be hard. The world is gonna try to hit us when we least expect it. Class of 2023, use everything that we've learned here at our time at HVA. And make it to only the finish line that matters. When I get there, I hope to see you all at the welcome table.
Good morning, guys. I can clearly still remember and see your sweet little faces, your very first handshake. You guys were ready to take on the world, well, at least HVA. Somehow, while you guys were busy doing your math and your English, your history, making friends, some that will last an entire lifetime, you were playing basketball and volleyball and soccer and doing music performances, and sometimes you even found time to come to work in the cafeteria. Mrs. Lutz has also been very busy, documenting your memories for the last 4 years. On graduation morning, we stand here. It's been 4 years. and 4 years is just not long enough this morning. But here you are. We'd like to take a few minutes and share some of your memories with your friends and family. We'd also like to take just a minute and thank you for sharing your children with us for the last 4 years. Enjoy.
Thank you. This morning, our speaker will be someone extremely special to the class of 2023. Without this teacher, sponsor, mother, historian, and overall amazing woman, our class would not have half of the opportunities we've had in our 4 years together. These opportunities include, but are definitely not limited to winning Campus Cup. Mrs. Lutz was very picky about class participation points, going to Puerto Rico for class trip, and somehow having enough time to have class meetings and learn material in an hour and 15-minute U.S. government block. This woman works extremely hard in everything she does and is a prime example to her kids at school of what passion, love, and a gentle but strong spirit looks like. She's not only taught us U.S. history and U.S. government, but also taught all of us how to work hard for what we want, how to take things seriously, and how to create a beautiful and meaningful future. She's never left a child behind and sees every one of her students as her own kids. She's someone that the class of 2023 will never forget. It is an honor to present our speaker for the commencement of class of 2023, Mrs. April Lutz.
Have to make sure I have all my things ready here. Water. I keep thinking that there can't be any more tears, but I think that they're still coming. Good morning, friends, family, HVA faculty and staff, and almost graduates. Welcome to the Highland View Academy commencement ceremony for the class of 2023. Look at you. What a good-looking and accomplished class you are. It is such a privilege to stand here and see every single one of you sitting on this stage. I look at all of your faces, and I see the incredible young men and women that you are. At the same time, I see baby-faced freshmen who showed up on this campus 4 years ago, and I bet if I asked your parents and grandparents in the audience right now, they would somehow both be seeing the newborn, the toddler, the middle schooler, and the 18-year-old all simultaneously. I am so proud to have been your class sponsor for these past 4 years, and I'm honored to be your commencement speaker today, even if I think you may have asked me just to get me back for debates and essay exams. We have been side by side for 4 years, and it seems like just yesterday that you arrived as excited and nervous freshmen. I did not get the chance to teach you that year, but we spent time together in our class meetings. You guys had these massively grand ideas, and I would gently say, yes, but what if we did this much more reasonable and doable option? We planned our first annual Chipotle fundraiser, which is now a midwinter staple at HVA. We started collecting for a yard sale that would not happen for 2 years. And we designed some really bold class t-shirts. Can you believe that you thought wild and free class of 2023 was a good idea? I remember Josh showing up to our first event in bright red jeans, which he would proceed to wear to every essay event for 4 years. And Mario would bike to 2 hours to school every day when he didn't have a ride because he was excited to be here. I remember thinking that Sophia was maybe not my biggest fan at first, and I wondered how we would work together as president and sponsor, but that's something that we have now done successfully and with so many precious memories for 4 years. And I remember thinking that there was no way Brandon was old enough to be a freshman with his baby face and mop of hair, which has only, as you can see, gotten more impressive. And Hannah started her tenure as HVA's loudest cheerleader ever. And then we were suddenly online in a whirlwind of chaos and unprecedented events, ending that first year together as in little Zoom windows. But in their sophomore year, we were back on campus. We were seated 6 feet apart and in masks. We had few events, and those that we did have were outside or online, but we were not deterred. We were back in our class meetings, planning and working towards the goal of a truly great senior trip to the Virgin Islands. And once we weeded through the craziest of Herbert's what-if-we scenarios, We planned some truly amazing fundraisers, and we have had so many fundraisers. Our yard sale and car wash, the second annual Chipotle fundraiser, completed in COVID fashion by having all students place their orders online, get in the bus, and sit in the bus while the staff ran in to collect their items, except for Malcolm's, because after waiting for a very long time, we discovered that he never actually submitted an order. We put on some great Spirit Week skits, and we gave the seniors a run for their money on Campus Cup that year. And then they were juniors, and I finally got the privilege of having them in class. I got to see their intelligence, critical thinking, and resourcefulness in a whole new light. And while I missed part of that first semester, I came back to our junior talent show, where Brendan showed us that he was really just a surfer boy at heart. And it was that year that we gained Carlos and Isabel and Gookie and Kamari as classmates. We slowly watched Carlos's gruff silence turn to a cheerful smile. Isabel's polite smile, as she pretended to know what you were saying when she absolutely did not, turned into an outgoing and artistic presence in our class. And poor Googie's name get butchered a million ways, usually while being said in the highest pitch voice possible, as he just rolled his eyes and shook his head. As juniors, you suffered a heartbreaking loss in the Campus Cup soccer tournament, even though Kia did her very best to save us. But we dominated academic and Bible Bowl, and really what's more important, soccer or academics? You experienced a year's worth of Baby Wednesdays as you went from staring at a lump of a baby waving her arms on the floor to chasing her down the hallways. And more excitedly, the masks came off, the desks moved closer together, and the dorms opened up, and life started to finally feel normal again. And doesn't it feel like it was just yesterday when you guys walked into this building on registration day with your whole senior year ahead of you? You started U.S. government, terrified by the idea of reading political philosophy and debating in front of your class. And I got the privilege of watching Julie and Alex come alive in their passion for politics, current events, and discussing critical issues, while Nate would chime in on the rarest of occasions from his typical standing position. Oge joined our class and quietly bided her time before showing herself to be hilarious and outrageous all the time. We had the best time transforming the gym to Sherwood Forest, and Davian would try on an almost daily basis to sneak into his chair while I wasn't looking so I wouldn't know he was late. He never made it. Kamari would send me regular frantic texts in all caps as she was working on something or running late. And Katie would make David Trone, the Maryland U.S. representative for the 6th District, her lock screen as we wandered around Washington, D.C. Brendan and Herbert would finally confess to a 4-year-old crime at Friendship Vespers, which will always be one of my all-time favorite memories. And all the while, Sam would be sitting in the back corner, smiling and shaking his head at his class's daily shenanigans. And while we did not make it to the Virgin Islands, we got pretty close and spent 3 amazing days in the sun and sand in Puerto Rico. I could go on and on forever. And as these guys know, I love to rehash the past. And while these last 4 years have seemed like an eternity of unprecedented events, it has truly flown by. But my point is this. We have been through a lot in these 4 years together. Class meetings, class parties, our amazing class trip, class highs and lows. History classes in block periods filled with a lot of talking, debating, discussing, arguing, studying, lecturing, and more class meetings. And I'm trying to figure out what more they think I could possibly have to say to them. Are you wanting me to remind you of the imperialistic tendencies of the United States during the Spanish-American War? Okay. Or perhaps you are dying for a refresher about the complexity of rights and obligations in the U.S. Bill of Rights? How about we just debate between John Locke and Jean-Jacques Rousseau? Yay! I know. You want to talk about the biggest things happening in the news right now so we can debate them in front of everybody. Luckily, as they well know, I always have more to say. Almost every class ends with me lamenting the lack of time. And while your main exposure to me has come through my love of history and the truths about personal, community, and national identity it can teach us, I do not want to focus on the past right now. We could spend this whole time recalling fond memories of HVA, or at least some pretty crazy ones, but this is your last required Highland View Academy event. You are about to embark on your next great adventure, and there is so much in front of you. It is my hope, as it is for all of the faculty and staff who have devoted ourselves to you, that you use the knowledge and experience you have gained here to shape your future, but that is completely up to you. You are sitting here because of the choices you have made over the last 4 years, but let's be a bit more clear. You are not here just because you chose to be, or because you decided it and it magically happened. You are not even here because I harassed some of you on a daily basis about your grades leading up to this moment. Something else had to take place between when you made the decision to get to this moment and actually sitting here. You had to act on that choice. And while some of you may have acted sooner than others, or more purposefully than others, in the end, you're sitting here because you did it. Can you believe you're here? This is your graduation. You just walked down the aisle to the classic song with the slow, awkward eternity walk in full regalia. Everyone here is for you, or is here for you. You guys did it. Obviously, you had the emotional, financial, academic, and physical support of the people in this room, and you have the breath and talents that God gave you. But in spite of all that help, you had to do it. You went to class every day, and sometimes you were on time. You read some of the material. You took the tests. You wrote the papers. And this is where I could make one more joke about ChatGPT, but I'm going to pass on that. Dr. Spence from WAU said it clearly when he visited last month. Do you remember what he said? He said, your dreams are nothing without goals, and your goals are nothing without actions. You have dreamt of this day for years, and they have dreamt of this day for longer. You had the goal of getting this diploma, but unless you purposefully acted on that, you would not be sitting here today. Now, you know I don't give my personal opinion about many things in class. I much prefer to question you, why you think or believe what you do. I'm about to tell you one thing I believe right now. And no, it's not going to be how I voted in the last elections. What I think about the newest controversial topic, or what I think about some celebrity drama. Sorry. Let's take it all the way back to first quarter. Who remembers what we studied in government class? Philosophy, luckily. And which of the philosophers did we talk about compassion? Rousseau, they remember something. Do you remember our heated discussion about whether compassion requires action or if it's just a feeling? Who thought it was a feeling? If I remember correctly, the majority of your class said it was just a feeling. But we also thought, who thought it was an action? Now, we have a lot of people who aren't raising their hands. This is how our class meeting votes normally go. It's very, very efficient. Do you know what you want to know what I think? I think that your compassion is useless and empty without action. My feeling of compassion towards someone else is worth a pot of beans, the very unmagical kind, if I don't do what I can to help them. And honestly, I think this applies to everything. Now, I know many of us have been told the old adage that it is the thought that counts, that as long as you intend well, you can't go wrong. But as Abbot Bernard of Clairvaux famously said, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. I believe we are nothing but our actions. Of course, we have our feelings, our inner desires, our inner biases, beliefs, and struggles, but they do not define us nearly as much as how we choose to act on those things or because of those things. It is not what you planned to say that counts. It is what actually comes out of your mouth that can uplift or tear down. It is not what you planned to do or hoped you would be. It is what you actually do that impacts those around you and your own future. The lower classmen of HVA will not remember what you thought of them or what you intended to be as a senior. They are only going to remember your class based on how you actually treated them, what you said to them, how you acted at school events, in the classroom, on the field, or on the court, or at worship. And this is not just my personal opinion. I always ask you guys to prove what you think. I believe this truth is written across our personal lives. When we fight with someone, what matters more, what they meant to say or what words actually came out of their mouth? Once it comes out, they can't take it back, no matter what they meant. That stuff sticks with you. And how do your friends treat you on a daily basis? Everyone in this room can think of a time when someone who claims they care about them acted in a way that may have hurt them or said something that comes back to mind sometimes. We do not forget how people treat us. It is formative in who we become and how we think of ourselves, and others will not forget how you treat them. But let's look a little bigger than our little personal bubble. This truth is written across history. We study those who did something, said something, acted in the face of something, and thus impacted their lives, their family, their community, their country, or the whole world. Our history books are not filled with people who thought about doing something, only those who did, or the worst of them all, we study those who chose not to act and ask how they could have done nothing in the face of so much something. Doesn't matter if they hoped to, wanted to, planned to. In history and in all practical terms, it only matters if they did. Most importantly, this truth is written across our faith. We can look at one example after another in Scripture that shows us that words are empty without action, that your thoughts and beliefs are useless without action, and that even your prayers and faith that God will hear them and answer them are dead without action. James 2 is clear. To see someone in need and offer them your kind words, faith, and prayer instead of acting on their physical present need in any way you can, that is the sign of a dead faith. It is useless and rotten. All of your compassion and prayers are offensive to true faith if you can do something and choose not to. Yes, pray unceasingly. Yes, think always of those who need help. Yes, share your faith because we know it is the only cure to what truly ails this world. But the question is, what can you do about it? Let's think of the story of the Good Samaritan. We all know it. A man is attacked and left for dead. He waits for help, and as he hears the footsteps of the first passerby, he has hope that he will be saved. And yet, what does the priest do? He, conscientious of the rules and expectations of his office, moves across the road and passes him by. And so too does the Levite, again, thoughtfully keeping himself away from contact with someone who would threaten his ability to perform his duty as a spiritual leader. Both of these men were obeying God's law about ritual purity and spiritual leadership with the best intentions, but they are the villains in this story. It is the Samaritan who acted against the social norms, prejudices, and legalism of the time, who did something transformative and worthy of emulation. This is a clear moment when Jesus does not equivocate. He says, "Do not use me to justify not getting down on the ground and lifting people up." In Matthew 25, in the parable of the sheep and the goats, what is it that distinguishes those who truly know Jesus and those he doesn't recognize? It was their action and interaction with those who were in all kinds of need. "I was hungry and you gave. I was thirsty and you gave. I was naked and you gave. I was in jail and you came to me." And when those on the other side said, "What about us?" he says, "I don't even know you because you did nothing." Let's look at a story of intentions from a different perspective. Let's look at Jonah, perhaps one of the most unlikable prophets in the Bible. Why? Because he had the worst intentions. He allowed the prejudice and bias of his time to win over his duty to the cause of Christ. Jonah did not want to go to Nineveh. To those idol worshipers, those heathens, never. Jonah runs away from God. But God forgives after a brief, rather scary, three-day lesson. And Jonah goes and he preaches of the destruction they will face. But the Ninevites, luckily, recognize and repent of their ways, and God forgives them, embraces them, and does not allow destruction to come to their city. And what does Jonah do? He gets so mad that they will not face the consequences he prophesied that he asks God to kill him. This man saved an entire city of men, women, and children, and yet he would rather sit on a hill and watch God destroy them. Jonah's intention was to see them punished, but his actions saved them. Your actions have unspeakable power. Power to do good, unbelievable world-changing things, and power to do irreparable harm. And what is so scary is that that harm can be done whether you intend it or not. And that is heavy. How do we make sure our actions and intentions align, and most importantly, align with God's perfect plan for our lives? I have a favorite way of encouraging critical thinking and analysis. Most students see it as a terror tactic, and they dread the dozens of pen marks that consist of a single word, why. Too rarely do we focus on the significance, impact, and relevance of a thing. In the words we choose to respond with, the things to which we devote our time, the content we choose to ingest physically, mentally, and emotionally, every moment is a chance to improve ourselves, our relationships, and the world around us, or to injure all of it. Too many of us, especially young people who feel they have all the time and opportunity in the world, do not pay attention to why we do these things. Why did I watch it or listen to it? Why did I respond in that tone or use those words? Why did I spend my time doing this thing instead of another? Why didn't I do something? The answer to all this is your purpose. You must set a purpose. You must know what your purpose is, and then you'll be able to work and to act accordingly. When confronted with an opportunity or when you are interacting with another, you must respond to a situation. Stop and think about your initial impulse and ask, why would I respond that way, or choose that way, or do it that way? How does what I choose to do here further or harm my purpose? I know this seems like a lot of thinking, but trust me, everyone who has ever made a choice that they regret, it is worth it. And it becomes easier with time. As you establish the habit of speaking, acting, and doing things only in accordance with your purpose, you will find that it becomes almost intuitive. We all know those people who are so in tune with who they are and what their purpose is that their actions and words are almost predictable and unwavering in their commitment to that purpose. And those people inspire every room they walk into. You should be those kind of people. Your difficulty is that you're right at the beginning of this huge obstacle course of life. While some of you have already made the decision to root into your God-given purpose, others have no idea what your purpose is. And you have to first know your purpose before you can act it out daily. Finding your purpose is no easy task, but the failure to do so is the main reason why so many kids fall to the wayside the year or two after high school graduation. This next year will be transformative, but do not let it shape you. You need to shape it. Do not let early adulthood happen to you. You need to confront it head on and challenge yourself every day to be the college student, employee, and person you want to be. And be that in every word you speak, in every action, and in every choice. Now, I know you're thinking, that all sounds very great, but how am I supposed to know what my grand soul-defining lifelong purpose is at 18? And you have a point. You guys are babies. And yes, you're seniors, and you're graduating from high school and have been the big fish on campus for a couple years now, but you are a big fish in a little puddle, and you are about to get tossed into the ocean. There is so much about this world that you do not know, no matter how much you think you do. I'm not saying you have to have everything figured out today. I'm not saying you have to have this depth of wisdom that allows you to make lifelong decisions at 18, but I am saying that you can know what you are about right now. Your purpose may change with time and experience, but it should always be established in the same principles. Your purpose should guide your life, decisions, influence your behavior, shape your goals, offer a sense of direction, and create meaning in your life. Your purpose is not your profession. Your purpose may not always make you happy or be the easy way. Your purpose may create conflict at times, but your purpose should bring you joy and meaning. It should foster healthy relationships, both platonic and romantic, and it should give you peace, even when you have to make a difficult decision. Your purpose should motivate you to be better, even if you already think you're pretty good. Having a good time is not a purpose. Getting married is not a purpose. Having children is not a purpose. Becoming a millionaire is not a purpose. If these are things you want in life, that's great. And when you become a millionaire, remember your history teacher and devoted class sponsor. But when it comes to understanding your purpose, it is important to ask yourself a few questions. If there are certain goals that you want to attain, ask yourself, why do you want to attain those things? Does my purpose impact more than just me? Does my purpose make me excited to get out of bed in the morning? Maybe not every morning, because that's impossible, but most mornings? If you knew you would not be around in a year, what would you do with your time? And how would you hope people remember you? If you had to go out and do something every day, not sit at home and watch Netflix, what would you want it to be and why? How are you going to save this world? What makes you forget to eat and sleep because you're too excited about it to stop? What is true about you today that your 8-year-old self might be disappointed by? Critically and thoughtfully asking yourself these questions will help you understand your purpose in life. I know you keep waiting for me to get to the part where I tell you what your purpose should be, but I am not here to tell you what your purpose is. When have I ever given you an easy answer? I'm here to challenge you to find it, because your purpose is unique to you. I can't tell you what your purpose is, but I know what I hope defines it, what the principles are that it's based on. I hope that you devote yourself to the improvement of others. I hope you devote yourself to improving this world because it is so ugly and needs wise, thoughtful, caring people like you. I hope you choose to never stop learning and to increase your knowledge of the world around you so that you can engage other people, cultures, and perspectives with kindness and acceptance. I hope you choose to improve yourself so you can be a role model to everyone who looks your way. And while you may not all be Christian, I do hope that you open your minds and hearts to the principles of love, compassion, accountability, justice, and self-sacrifice that should characterize all followers of Christ. I want you to strive to be the kind of person that others look at and think, what is it about them that is so impressive, so thought-provoking, so alluring? Not to boost your ego, but because it's a natural reaction to the life of excellence you hopefully choose to live and the light of Christ's character shining through you. I hope that you take control of yourself and shape the world instead of allowing a jaded, bitter world to shape you. Class of 2023, I could keep you here for hours with my hopes and dreams for you, but I've kept you almost long enough. So let me leave you with this. Think of someone whose actions or words truly made an impact in your life, or in the world, or in history. Think of that one person and the changes that they brought, and now imagine that impact times 20. The potential that is represented on this stage is unfathomable. The change that could be wrought, the lives that could be touched, and the transformative and uplifting relationships that could be built just by the power of the actions of this one class could be enough to restructure the entire world. But it is up to you. You need to find your purpose. And when you do, give everything to it and leave no reserves. Pursue it and never retreat. And even if or when things go wrong or the way appears too hard to bear, never regret your purpose. As William Borden said, be done with low living, sight walking, small planning, smooth knees, colorless dreams, tamed visions, mundane talking, cheap living, and dwarfed goals. Do not be bought, compromised, detoured, lured away, turned back, deluded, or delayed. Do not flinch in the face of sacrifice or hesitate in the presence of the adversary. Do not negotiate at the table of the enemy. Ponder at the pool of popularity or meander in the maze of mediocrity. Make your colors, your actions, your words so clear so that when the time comes, Christ has no trouble recognizing you as his own because you acted out your purpose to the fullest extent. May he and everyone you meet recognize that your road is not paved with empty good intentions and missed opportunities, but moments of action on behalf of your fellow man for the cause of Christ. I've actually made it almost the whole time without this. Tomorrow, you are alumni of Highland View Academy. Please water the seeds that we have planted in you. And if you need more seeds, you can come home to us and we'll give you more. We love you. We are so proud of you. We are going to miss you. And we cannot wait to see all of the amazing, purposeful things that you will do. Congratulations, class of 2023. You did this. Now go do more.
It's a great challenge for all of us, isn't it? This is a wonderful part of every graduation ceremony in a Seventh-day Adventist high school in the North American division. It is time to recognize a very deserving young person who has a spirit of service and leadership. So if you will join me in this year's Caring Heart Award, it is a Christian Service Award given in recognition of the demonstrated leadership and personal commitment to witnessing and service activities. And this is basically why Highland View Academy exists, is to teach and train and engage young people in service and in witnessing. And it is with great joy that I award this Bible, this $500 scholarship, and this plaque to Ricardo Hernandez. At this time, I am proud to invite Dr. Jonathan Scriven to the platform to share some awards from Washington Adventist University.
Good morning. It occurs to me I'm maybe one of the last things standing between these graduates and their diploma, so I will be brief. My name is Dr. Scriven, Jonathan Scriven. I am the Associate Director of the Honors College at Washington Adventist University. I also run the History, Political Science, and Law Department. And I am very proud to offer congratulations on behalf of Dr. Spence, our President, on behalf of Dr. Kasunzu, our Provost, and our entire faculty and staff. You know, we have two basic goals at Washington Adventist University. The first is to engage minds and transform lives. And we do that through an educational opportunity that focuses on moral leadership for today, for tomorrow, and for eternity. And that's something we're very proud of. The second thing we try to do at WAU is make sure that we are a service resource for the Columbia Union. And we do that in a number of ways as well. One, through our educational opportunities for our students. A second way, though, is by providing service and opportunity for Academy students within the Columbia Union. Things like a music fest, things like an acro fest, which I know some of you have taken part in. And my personal favorite, something called Model United Nations. And I want to speak to that for just 1 second. Many of you are aware that we have a Model United Nations program. It's called Capital MUN. Highland View is one of our staunchest supporters of that, thanks in large part to Mrs. Lutz, who is amazing. But this year we did something a little extra special. I'm going to ask five people on the stage right now to stand, and they will know who they are. They're the five students who traveled with me and some other students to The Hague, Netherlands. Go ahead, stand up. Five of you. I'm going to ask them to stay standing for just 1 second. This year, through the Honors College, we were able to secure a position at something called The Hague International Model United Nations Conference, the largest and oldest MUN conference in the world. It's held in the Netherlands every January. These five students, as well as students from Tacoma Academy, Spencerville, and I think Pine Forge Academy as well, participated in a several-day conference where we debated global issues with 2,500 other students from around the world. And I want to just say one thing. Many of the schools that participate in this conference have been doing so for decades. The conference is now 53 years old. This was the first time ever that a delegation of Seventh-day Adventist students went to this conference. And this conference has students from schools that are some of the most famous high schools and most prestigious high schools in the world. And they debate global issues. I want to let you all know, as you look at these five students, that our delegation not only held its own, they shined. They shined. Another round of applause, please. It really was just an honor of a lifetime for me to go on this trip, and of course, Ms. Lutz was there as well, and that was wonderful. The other way that we want to be a service to the Columbia Union is by affording or giving students an opportunity to have this education at a reasonable price. Our president always says he wants students to graduate with little or no debt. That's why I'm here. I'm not going to go through the whole list of awards, but I want to introduce a couple people in the back. I have a colleague in our admissions department whose name is Austin. He's there. I have a wonderful student who some of you will remember, Shay Standish, who's a graduate of this very institution. And they both have certificates with a lot of scholarships for these students. This is a great academic class. Just to give you an idea, in this envelope, there are 15 certificates that together, when totaled up, equal $400,000 of academic scholarship. So that is worth another round of applause for these terrific students. We recognize that there are lots of terrific educational opportunities for students within our Adventist system, outside our Adventist system. We also realize that for many students, WAU provides exactly what they need. We have some unique opportunities that are unique within our system. So what I'm going to ask the graduates to do, and even parents, is take a moment after the service to come and talk with one of us and let us see what we can do in terms of providing the financial resources that you would need. And if you're not planning to come to WAU, we wish you all the best. If you are, I can't wait to see you in the fall. Thank you.
Are you guys ready? Highland View Academy would like to invite the staff parents, alumni parents, or alumni grandparents of their graduating child to join them on the stage to turn the tassels. According to our records, the parent or parents of Herbert Dennison IV and Brandon Hurd have attended HVA, and Ms. Uni Bonwag is a staff member. Please join us on the stage. When your child's name is called, please step by Pastor Jerry Lutz to turn their tassel. This is the time that we have all been waiting for. Pastor Lutz, Mr. Geddes, HVA faculty and staff, we have reviewed the records of these students seated before you, and I am very pleased to announce that they have met all of the graduation requirements and are eligible to receive their diplomas. Will the first row please rise to receive your diploma? Graduating with honors, Sophia Marquez. Samuel Lopez Machado. Julie Ann Herder. Herbert Millard Dennison IV. Graduating with honors, Catherine Alice. Carlos Fabricio Funes Rodriguez. Alexandra Yvette Cruz. Graduating with honors, Joshua Ray Roberts. Graduating with high honors, Brandon Lee Hurd. Malcolm Edward Kilby. Lule and Kunda Kafiro. graduating with honors, Kiara Isabel Fernandez Banwag. Graduating with high honors, Hannah Lynn Bellevo. Graduating with high honors, Brendan Stephen Coyle Pillai. Isabel Victoria Memani, Portugal. Mario Alberto Moya. Graduating with honors, Davian Alexander Neverson. Ogechukwu Okereke. Nathaniel Hyungwoo Perry. Graduating with honors, Kimari Paris Wright. Congratulations to the class of 2023.
My name is Colleen Lay. I'm the STEM coordinator here at Highland View Academy. I represent a STEM team, which is comprised of myself, Mr. Kenji Nomura, mathematics technology teacher, Ms. Rose Mutiso, biological environmental science teacher, and our 28 hardworking, dedicated STEM students. On behalf of this team, it is our pleasure to grant 3 STEM certificates today. In 2015, Mrs. Ophelia Bariso founded the STEM certificate program here at HVA. Her purpose for this program was to educate and inspire students to be technologically literate, innovative, problem solvers, critical thinkers, so they would be ready to make a difference in the world beyond this campus. Our STEM certificate students must complete the core requirements for the college preparatory diploma, including GPA requirements, maintain minimum grade requirements for STEM courses and electives, complete 20 hours of STEM-centered community service, and also complete an 80-hour internship in a STEM-related area. All 3 of these graduates made it through the COVID years when we had no STEM service and we couldn't do hardly anything. And we're so proud of them. They persevered, and they have definitely been a valuable part of our STEM department, and we are going to miss them dearly. They've been involved in our local church as well, and our elementary schools, and as well as been great mentors to our up-and-coming STEM graduates. The graduates completing the STEM certificate program requirements this year are Brandon Lee Hurd, Davian Alexander Neverson, Joshua Ray Roberts, with your certificates, you're receiving a small gift from the STEM department, but it is actually a gift from all of our STEM team. So we hope you'll not only enjoy your reading, but also all the well wishes that are written in there from your STEM students and your STEM teachers. Today, we celebrate your accomplishments in our department. However, again, it is our hope and prayer that we have taught you more than science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. We hope we have challenged you, pushed you, given you opportunities to do things you never thought possible. We hope that you will go forward today and use your skills and talents to make a difference in this world and honor the Creator who gave them to you. Congratulations from our STEM team. May God bless you.
I'm excited to be able to tell you that the group of 20 seniors up here, the group of graduates up here from Highland View Academy have earned a total from 5 different Adventist universities and colleges. They have earned almost $1.2 million in scholarships. It's my opportunity as principal to give you a charge, to send you out with a challenge. I know I've been with you this weekend. You've received a lot of instruction. And so I just want to keep this very simple. God loves you, and He has given you a design for your life. And I just want to share Micah chapter 6, verse 8 with you. God is sharing with you the charge if you choose to accept it. He, meaning God, has shown you, O graduate, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? But to do justly to everyone all the time. Do justly. To love mercy. Give people a break. It's amazing what they can do with those breaks. And class of 2023, walk humbly with your God. He loves you.
Graduates, on behalf of the Chesapeake Conference of Seventh-day Adventists and the Education Department, I want to also congratulate you on your accomplishments today, and I want to let you know that we've been praying for you at the conference office, and we'll continue praying for you as you go on in your journey in life. We're proud of you, and we're so glad that each one of you chose Highland View Academy as your academy. And we hope you'll come home often. We hope to see you on alumni weekend. Come back. At your feet, at the bottom of your chairs, there's a little gift for each one of you from the conference office. And it's just a little something to let you know that we love you, that you can take with you wherever you go next. Put it on your desk. There's a lot of useful little things in there for you that you've probably been borrowing from your mothers and fathers until now. And you might use some of those things later on. But we just wanted you to know we love you, so we have a little thing there for you. And I also want to leave you with one of my favorite Bible verses, and it is Psalm 37:4. It says, "Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart." It's my desire today that all your dreams will come true and that Jesus will be at the front of every dream you have. Congratulations.
Well, on behalf of the Alumni Association, our dearest HVA class of 2023, you can tell I wrote that, you've made it. On behalf of the Highland View Academy Alumni Association, we want to be the first to officially congratulate you on finishing high school. We've waited for this moment for so long. Now here you are, you're officially finished, and the easiest thing you'll ever do in your life.
Of course, we are sad for this temporary goodbye, but we are so excited for you guys to go out into the world and to bring about change for God's glory. Though you're leaving this campus, you are forever a part of this esteemed small group of highly famous individuals around the world known as Highland View Academy alumni.
So we pulled some alumni, and these are some of the important things that you must know when you leave here and become an alumni. Now that you're a graduate, you can now address your teachers, staff by their first names, no Mr., Mrs., or Dean in front of it.
So if, for example, Mrs. Lutz is now April. Also, as of midnight tonight, you will automatically all receive blue check marks on all social media platforms.
I don't know what that means. Once a tartan, always a tartan. However, you will now be rooting for the alumni tartans. And I expect Sam to score 3 goals on the team next year. So.
Also, apart from the unexplained body aches and new gray hairs every day, it only gets better from here.
From now on, you can use the restroom without asking for permission. But please use this freedom responsibly.
You are now in charge of styling yourself. No more uniforms. Well, until you get a job and then you have a new dress code.
You now have the honor of paying for your parents' lunch when you go out to eat with them. Um, Also, you have the honor of being able to buy toys as you would like, you know, whatever you want, especially Legos. And you can also get a new pet every week if you'd like.
You also, in your free time, can help your former teachers grade homework. And also, you have the express joy of now paying taxes.
And from now on, you'll never have the feeling of being late when you drive on this campus. Well, until you have kids. Also, it's probably a good idea for you guys to learn how to cook.
And of course, as you guys know, with great power comes great. That is right. And also know that things will not always go your way, but that's okay. Of course, there's so much more that we could tell you, but this is just the beginning. Will all the present alumni please stand at this time? You guys should be standing. You're alumni. You guys need to know that to be a part of this family means that you always have support. You always have someone to call, and you always have a place to go. Never hesitate to come and visit, to support financially, or to reach out to a fellow alumnus.
Go out into the world and take it by storm. Remember to seek the guidance and peace of God every step of the way.
And my dear class of 2023, I'm going to be in the dining hall, sitting at the table that says HVA. So I want to see you at that welcome table.
Amen.
We have another group of wonderful young people here this morning that has waited patiently for this time. And so before we get super exuberant and excited, I would like to ask our class of 2024 to stand and face the congregation. I am proud to introduce to you the new senior class of 2024 Highland View Academy.
Congratulations, class of 2024. Please bow your heads and close your eyes and join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for allowing this class and everybody to get together for this wonderful celebration. Thank you for navigating us through this journey and bringing us to the end of this chapter. And thank you for giving us such wonderful family members, peers, and staff. All I ask is that in the future, you navigate us through whatever we have coming towards us and bless us throughout the rest of our lives. Amen. Amen.
Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? Here we go. Come on. time to get the good started.
What we leave, what we take with us, no matter what. Graduation day, time to get the future started.
When we leave, when we take, we lay,
time to get.